Philippians chapter 1. Philippians 1, and we wanted to start. We left off with 16 and 18, so I didn't do 17, but I want, before we can really move on down to 19 and 20, we need to make sure that we've comprehended, particularly verse 16 and what follows that. Verse 16 says, "The one preached Christ of contention, not sincerely, supposing to add affliction to my bonds." And these people, you know, he's contrasted too. There's those who preach Christ with sincerity, not of love. And there are those who preach or bring a message of contention with the purpose of adding affliction. Adding means they already have some. He's in prison. He's suffering all the separation from other people and whatever problems. But these people are doing this under the supposition that they are adding affliction to this person. Okay? That's their purpose, is to add affliction on top of an already afflicted person. All right. Well, when you put it that way, that sounds bad. But let me tell you, it is a human supposition that when your enemy is down, when your enemy is hurting, whoever that is, whoever doesn't like you, whoever would have cause to attack you, whoever, whether now or next week or next month or next year or 2 years from now, in other words, what we're talking about right now is not applicable for a class. It is applicable for a place in time for you. Please don't take this just as a Bible school class, because somewhere down the road, this is going to happen. And when it does, you're going to be faced with how to react. So Paul knows their motive, and he knows that their motive is malicious towards him. Okay? Let's just think about that for a minute. You ever known, had somebody coming against you, and you knew their motive, and their motive was malicious against you? They wanted to add more affliction to your life. Anybody? Several of you. Okay. All right. It's fun to talk about these things in a classroom setting with no application. But it's a different story when you're in that situation and it's going on because your theology is not the only thing at work in you. Your emotions, your soul, your reactions, your anger, your prejudices, your previous knowledge, all of that is rising up and can affect you in this situation. The problem with these people in this situation is they have supposed wrong. They have supposed wrong. they have supposed, based on the human supposition, that affliction is going to make more affliction, dumping stuff on you is going to make your life miserable. Right? Is that right or wrong? And let me tell you, let's just say it. If you are still a child of God and not a son of God by Christ, if Christ has not been revealed in you, then how in the world can you respond any other way, even if you're a child of God? Because the scriptures say in, you know, Galatians 4, now I say that the heir, an heir can only be an heir because he's in the family, right? Now I say that the heir, as long as he is a child or immature or, you know, and our version of maturity is not the Lord's version of maturity, we would say that doesn't apply to me because I know many deep things. But he's not talking about knowing many deep things. He's talking about how you handle things. And now I say that the heir, as long as he is a child, differeth nothing from a servant, one who's not in the family. He's got the same reactions. He's got the same fears. He's got the same soul responses. You understand? I mean, that's not rocket science there. That's just the way it is, because the only difference is Christ, not Christianity. Christ, not Christianity. Your favorite article when I met you in Washington. It's Christianity will not save you at those times. It will not. I'm sorry, it won't. And you will react like everybody else. And in a certain sense, you can't be expected but to react that way. You know, I'm not letting you off the hook when I say that. I'm not letting you off the hook. I'm just letting you know that, you know, when you know, because when you do that, you go, I can't believe I did that. Well, what? You know? If it's not, yeah, it's you. As long as it's you, there's going to be problems. Okay? Now I say that the heir, as long as he is a child, differeth nothing from a servant, though he be Lord of all. Meaning, in stature, let me just say it like this: the legality of the thing. You're a family member. You're an heir. You're Lord of all, as far as the Father is concerned. But you don't act like it. You don't know how to respond like it. And then he begins to talk about God sending forth the Spirit of his Son into your heart. To those who are heirs, to those who are Lord of all, but being lorded over by everything, every fear and every circumstance and everything. And so now I say that the heir, as long as he is a child, differs nothing from a servant, because he's a child, not a son. And those two words are used there in the Greek in that passage in Galatians 4. A child is teknon, and son is huios, and the difference that the Greek is trying to explain by two different words is an incredible leap from us to him, is an incredible leap from our life to the cross, and from the cross, the resurrection himself being the life. I am the resurrection and the life. The resurrection himself being the life. He didn't say I'm the life and the resurrection. He said I am the resurrection and the life. And so, there is a reality that we are not among those, or possibly are not among those who, when affliction is being applied maliciously, know how to turn that into resurrection. Hand me affliction.
resurrection.
For those of you listening and not watching this on DVD, it was pretty amazing what I just did. All right. The problem with these people that are doing this is they don't know that there's another kind of existence. They think that everybody's like them. Do you know what I'm saying? They really do. They think, well, if somebody, when I was down and out, if I was, you know, in the situation of Paul locked up and whatever, that if, you know, someone came along maliciously on top of all of that and was just dumping and heaping affliction, I'd be mad. And I know they will. I know this is, and they're smiling while they're doing it. I know this is making them, this is adding affliction to them and making them even more miserable. And they're smiling, going, yeah, mission accomplished. The key word here that Paul puts in here is the word supposing. Supposing to add affliction. They are supposing. They want to, and they're supposing that by doing this, they are destroying you. And again, this may not be applicable to you today. I've had someone recently tell me that something I shared many, many years ago popped into their head just at the right time. And hopefully popped into their heart, and I think it did. There is this group of beings. There's only one group in existence, but there is this group of beings that are unaffected by this. They are sons of God by Christ. They're not just saved. They're not just heirs. They're not just children. They're not just in the family. They're sons of God by Christ, and they understand how to handle what appears to be destructive forces. All right. So, because Christ is formed in Paul, that's where we get, verse 18, What then? Notwithstanding every way, whether in pretense or in truth, Christ is preached, and in that I do rejoice, yea, and will rejoice. And he's going to tell you why in the next verse, but we got to do verse 17 next. But he's telling you that he's in the process of rejoicing even at this extra stuff heaped on him, because he believes that life only comes out of death, that life does not mysteriously appear through fasting or prayer or through being diligent or faithful or committed going to the mission field, or life doesn't come out of any of those things. Life comes out of death. And the amazing central focus of all of Christianity is Christ and Him crucified. The Son of God, the one with all power, the one with all knowledge, the one with all resources, comes to earth to make a difference. But he doesn't come as the glorious, magnificent, all-powerful Oz, Son of God. He comes as a man, a weak man, because he came as not just a man, but a servant. You know, we'd say, why was Jesus born in a barn? Well, he should have been born in a palace. Well, would that make him any more who he really was? No, as a matter of fact, it would begin to hide who he really is, who God really is. He came to demonstrate the Father. And so of all the ways that he could have chosen, he came and he eventually, because he did miracles and he did teach and he did all the things that we're trying to do in the modern day church, miracles, teach, go around and preach, gather multitudes, have big gatherings. And at the end of three and a half years, he said, I've had enough. John 12:24. Except the corn of wheat fall into the ground and die, it abideth alone. But if it die, much fruit. Life comes out of death. And basically he's saying, I haven't brought forth any fruit up to this time because miracles and going around preaching and teaching and all that stuff had been carried on by Israel for, you know, thousands of years. And it didn't make a bit of difference. But Jesus knows, because he's God and he understands God, he understands the ways of God. He has a hard time understanding the ways of men, if you know what I mean, because mankind. And so God, the Son of God, lays down on two pieces of wood, lets them nail him up there, and goes into death knowing. Can I get amen on knowing? In other words, he didn't just die. He died with purpose. He died with intention. He knew what he was doing. He was a willing sacrifice. And all sacrifices that were before, all of them, were only shadows of this one who would actually have the right spirit, because none of them did that. No lamb, no sheep, no goat, no turtle dove, none of them had the right spirit, but they were at least, for the most part, chosen animals that would give you some sense of this one that was going to, a lamb, a dove. A lamb that becomes a goat, what I always call a lamb goat, because the goat part is he's bearing all of our sins, us. He's bearing the goats. See. And you see that great picture when all nations stands before him and he divides the sheep from the goats. He's saying that which is of my kind, and it's not what, you know, let me just say it like this. It's not what we think, even what I've said, the things that your little mind can run to. It is not what we think. It is in most cases, not just this area, but in most cases, it is so far beyond what we think. But all we can do is think in terms of our life and putting ourselves in that situation and the loss and the damage and the meanness and the allowance of evil, you know, allowing you to understand what I'm saying, that we would, oh, I can't do that. You know, Ed and I were talking about it on the way to dinner tonight, and that is, you know, but I didn't get into all this. But all of the movies that we, you know, we go see, you know, they, well, not all of them, but a bunch of them do have this thing where there's, you know, there's all this ugly evil. And then somebody comes, you know, I saw a commercial for Conan the Barbarian coming out. So. And oh, baby, they make the mean guys so mean and ugly that you are so ready for Conan to rip their heads and not think anything bad about it. Yeah! You know, and I don't know about girls, but a lot of times guys are going, because they just want to be that. Well, you're already that. You probably do it every day. Probably already attacking your enemies, fighting fire with fire. you know. You know what I'm saying? You're already doing that, so feel like a champion. And I don't even remember which one it was. Oh, yeah. Me and Deb went and saw Captain America. Oh, baby. Sick 'em, dude. Get 'em! You know. And I'm watching it, I'm going, you know, it never occurs to us how many people have died and how many people he's going through. All we see is another enemy defeated, you know. We don't see it as and I know, again, there's no way that you can comprehend this. I don't even want you to try. But there's no thought that every time I'm killing somebody, every time I'm taking this action, I'm actually missing out, giving up, surrendering an opportunity to bring forth life in this earth. I mean, you know, I remember it. I don't claim to have fully even understood it when God spoke to me. But we were in Colorado during 9/11. I guess we'd been having some sessions, hadn't we? Something? I don't even remember. There was a bunch of us there anyway. So I woke up, you know, Rob gave us his bedroom, and I woke up with people coming in saying, they just bombed the Twin Towers, and, you know, the whole world's on, and they're going for the Pentagon and all this stuff. And, you know, I mean, you could just feel the fear thick, not just in that room, I mean, across the United States. They came in and told me, but Deb got them out real quick because they knew I was sleepy-headed and it takes me a second to wake up. And I laid there and I said, well, what do you think, Lord? He said, increase the peace. That's what he said. Increase the peace. Never forget it. And I will admit to you, I don't think I fully grasped it, but I knew it was from God. I knew God spoke that to me. And I've known it since. That instead of reacting with the same stuff that they gave us, you know, let's go over to Iraq, let's go over to Afghanistan, just kill them all. If we kill them all, there won't be any more problems. Well, if you're going to kill all the enemies, you got to kill yourself. Because you're an enemy of God with that carnal mind of yours. The carnal mind is at enmity with God. Is that what it says? Yep. I'm just going to talk to you, Shay, because you're the only one getting it. And not only that, let me tell you something cool. There is a supposition. There is a supposition that we can get back at our enemies. Well, you can for the most part, unless they're in this one group of people that are new creations by Christ, that are sons of God, not just the church, that comprehend this, and there's no way, I mean, I'll be able to explain some things better when we get to chapter 2, but there's no way I can explain this sufficiently. There's no way, because there's too much of our mind and fears and all this stuff. So if I try to do it, we'll go, well, what about this? Well, what about that? Well, what about, you know, well, what about Jesus? What about the cross? What about the Word of God? What about, yeah, but what about, I mean, that ain't right. And what about this? That ain't right. Well, of course, you're absolutely right. It ain't right for you. You are right. It ain't right for you. So, you're all dismissed from Philippians class, because this is what we're going to, but we're going to discover some things, and hopefully it'll be helpful as we get into this. So, Paul is going, hey, notwithstanding, even though there's those against me, notwithstanding, I rejoice. I rejoice. And then verse 17, but the other of love, knowing that I am set for the defense of the gospel. The other of love. And this is the same self-giving love that Christ demonstrated on the cross. The same love that dies for its enemies. The same love that says in Romans 5, for the love of God is shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Spirit. And it describes that love. It describes it as him who gave himself for the ungodly, who died for the ungodly, who died for the ones who weren't deserving. All right. There's no need. Listen carefully, everybody. There's no need for us to do that if it's not going to be by Christ, because it won't result in anything other than you losing out and being stepped on. You know, do you understand what I'm saying? I mean, I'm just saying, I don't encourage this. I really don't. I don't encourage it. I encourage you to see Jesus. But I don't encourage this. But when a person has that Abba Father experience where the Son is revealed into them, they cry, Abba Father, there is a kindred spirit in them of this really small family, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. This is it. They don't speak of themselves. Father sends the Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit won't speak of himself, won't lift up himself, won't stand up for himself. He lifts up Jesus. Jesus doesn't declare himself. He declares the Father. It's a selfless thing. And I can tell you, well, no, I can't. But it is this family spirit. It is this Spirit of the Son. It is this Spirit of God. It is this Spirit of the Kingdom. It is this government of the Kingdom that will release. And I like that word in this case. It's going to release peace instead of doing to them what they did to me. Or more. I want to add affliction. I don't want to just do what they did to me. I want to add affliction to them. I want them to suffer. Well, again, I understand that. However, remember that picture we drew of the Son, and he comes down here and he looks at a cross, and trust me, they saw plenty of crosses in Israel. The Romans had thousands upon thousands hung on crosses. Jesus wasn't the only one. Jesus and two guys. No. The cross wasn't new for anybody. It's how it was approached. And why would you approach that cross in the first place if you're the Son of God? Change everything. Fix everything. Do something. Do something? Do something. Well, when someone says do something, they don't mean lay down your life. They don't. They mean do something. You know, you got the power. You have the power to slay the enemies. And instead, he climbs up on that cross and lets them slay him. Now, and then that becomes the symbol of all that represents God and all that represents Christianity. And yet, that's quick and gone and gone. And now let's get on with it. Being, do you understand, being powerful and being king's kids and all the other, you know, things that make us feel better about ourselves. You know, God isn't trying to make us feel better about ourselves. He's trying to make us feel worse so that you'll want Christ so bad that you'll finally embrace the cross instead of fight against it. Can I get amen?
Amen.
I mean, that really is it. You know, we go through all this stuff and go, why is all this? Why am I seeing all this stuff? Why is there something? Because God loves you enough to show it to you, to make it, you know, come out your nose. I mean, that's Israel. We want quail. We want quail. We want meat. We're sick of God's food. God's food isn't exciting. We want quail. So he gives them enough quail, till the Bible says, till it's coming out their nose. That's what it said. Well, I'm okay. Now you tell me why it would be coming out their nose, somebody. Why would, yes. Okay, what else? They're full of it. They are full of it. Because they are gluttonous and they're shoving flesh into their own being until it starts coming out their nose. Then they get sick of it. Then they're open to God. They never ask for quail again. They wanted to partridge in a pear tree after that, but they didn't ask for quail. No, there were other things, but God, our Father, must bring the dross to the surface so that he can scrape it off, so that he can only have pure gold. Gold represents what?
Deity.
Deity? Well, I just got to get the dross out of me so the deity can be seen. No, so Christ can be seen. He's the deity. It's not, there, you have no gold that pertains to you. And if you do, it's worth, right now, $1,684 an ounce. An ounce, right now. I'm thinking about getting rid of my wedding ring. Except for it's white gold and probably not worth the same. But anyway. y'all pray for me. Pray that I have, like, at least a month before I know I'm going to be dead. Because I'm going to go to the dentist and have him pull all the gold out of my teeth so that my wife will take it. Because she said, I tell her, now when I die, you take all, because I got it, baby. I am rich. I mean, I am. I went to the dentist to put in a new filling, and they pulled that gold filling out and put in the new one. And I said, where's that old filling? And they were shocked that I asked. I said, I paid for that. And then after they put it in a little thing and gave it to me, it took them a while. They were so shocked they couldn't believe it. And I said, how much do you think that's worth? And she said, and this has been a while back, she said, about $200. Then I went home and said, live in luxury after this. And it wasn't $1,600 announced then. It was like $300 or $400. Mm-hmm. I shouldn't have told some of you. It's like Babylon revealing all of its treasure. I'm in trouble now. If you find me dead and nothing but gums, you'll know it was my own fault. May only deity come out of my mouth. Only Christ. Amen? So, but the other of love, knowing that I'm set, of love, the same self-giving love that Christ demonstrated, they preach it knowing that Paul is set to handle whatever the consequences of prison or the affliction that people are trying to add, he's set to be able to handle that. His defense of the gospel isn't like ours. He doesn't defend the gospel by going, God is this cross stuff is right. You don't know. You know. I mean, I remember in my early days, man, I remember I was talking to somebody about God and Jesus and everything. I don't believe in Jesus. You know, and started talking bad, you know, and all this kind of stuff. And I started defending Jesus. And later, I went home. I was laying there in my bed, and the Lord spoke to me and said, I don't need you to defend me. You don't think I can take care of myself? I'm God. And what I got from that was, number one, defending him when he stood before his accusers, he stood before them as a sheep before its shears is dumb. He opened not his mouth. He didn't defend, but I'm going to jump in there and go, no, he's the real thing. If he's the real thing, it doesn't matter. I mean, isn't that right? If he's really the real thing, it doesn't matter because he's the real thing. It doesn't matter what they think. Like, them thinking that he's not make it true? Because that's the way I was reacting. Really, I was reacting like, anyway, I'm just thankful most of y'all have never done that. His defense of the gospel, the way to defend the gospel is to live according to it. And these people preached this thing of love, knowing that he was set to be able to go that route. Love, meaning self-giving, the way Jesus did. You see what I mean? Because the love they preached was agape love, which is Jesus kind of love. So not phileo or eros or any of those. It is the selfless giving for others who, and particularly for those who don't deserve it. All right. Let's see. Where are we at here now? All right, let's go to verse 19. For I know that this shall turn to my salvation through your prayer and the supply of the Spirit of Jesus Christ. Now, isn't it interesting that he didn't say the Spirit, the Holy Spirit? You know, there's a difference between Jesus, the Son of God, and God, the Holy Spirit, right? You know that? Because it didn't say the Holy Spirit. It said the supply of the Spirit of Jesus Christ, because the key for working this life out of death trick is the Spirit of Christ. Not you, and we'll get into this in the second chapter, not you trying to bring it about, because it won't work. It's just ridiculous. Don't try. No, I mean, you know, I mean, you can try. Maybe you need to try to see that you can. Then it must be Jesus. But I'm just saying, why try? Why not go with Jesus from the onset? Why not trust him for his life and nature instead of our own? Paul knows that handling his imprisonment by Christ crucified and handling all the other affliction that people throw at him will turn to resurrection, that's his salvation, and a new supply of the Spirit of Jesus Christ will be set forth. A new release, there's that word again, a new release. Christ, an increase of Christ. And that's what resurrection is, folks. It's an increase of Christ. Because if he comes up in, you know, let's just paint that picture. If he comes up in many bodies, it's still Christ that is the resurrection. Can I get an amen? I mean, he's still the resurrection. So it's just an increase of Christ. Well, that's what resurrection is. And that's the, you know, that is the salvation, or because I read a couple of translations of this, and they're saying this is how Paul will get out of his situation, meaning prison and being afflicted, his salvation. I guarantee Paul's salvation, I guarantee that his salvation isn't getting out of stuff. In fact, what we've read up to this point and what we're about to read in the rest of the verses is going to so slam any other translation of that. It blows it to smithereens. It doesn't just sort of go, well, maybe, you know, it could be this Christ crucified thing. No, it's going to give no room for any other thought, but this is what he's talking about. But again, here's our problem, and, you know, mine too. We tend to read one verse and separate it from everything around it because we don't understand how it fits in, and so we make up a little meaning for that apart from the context. You know? You ever done that? And it's, you know, the only hope for us is that the Holy Spirit will open the Word to, and then open our eyes to see Jesus. That's our hope, and that's why we search the Scriptures, and that's why most of us are in this place, and that's why our hearts burn within us when we hear the truth, because that's what we want. It's the truth that is in Jesus. Okay, so it says, let me just say this. Oh, I bet that's going to sound really good. Sorry to all of you, I dropped the microphone, and this is bad, but we're going back now. It's going to turn to resurrection, and a new supply of the Spirit of Jesus is going to be set forth. There it is, increase the peace. Stay in death, Paul. Don't fight this affliction thing, but use it. And by adding more, don't go with what they suppose, letting it add more affliction to you. But rejoice in it, because you are going to handle this by Christ, and it's going to result in resurrection, and a new supply of the Spirit of Christ is going to be coming forth out of you, Paul, and hopefully out of others. Now again, remember right now, every one of you, remember, that's my explanation. But that could not, that could, because I read a lot of other translators, and that's not what they went with. But when we get into the next scripture, it's going to definitively show, and the next few, that this is exactly what he's talking about. Okay, so yeah, one of the things you have to remember is sometimes scriptures are a little obscure. Amen. Sometimes it's hard to understand. You know, what is the meaning of that? And you can't find the meaning of that scripture in that scripture. Is that? But when you combine, you know, what you do is you have to make a sandwich. What went before and what's coming after it. You have to put that on, put that verse in between there, and then you can eat it. Then it makes sense. Then you see how, you know, it's not just some random weird, you know, well, because everything that Paul's saying here is, from the first verse on, is he's not trying to get out of anything. He's trying to use everything to bring forth more of Christ. Okay? So he's not saying that, and I I've read Bible translations, several. I'm just going, oh boy, that's exciting, you know. And this shall turn to my escape from these heathen. All right. So let's go ahead and go to verse 20. Praise God. We're moving now. Let's finish, and the supply of the Spirit of Jesus Christ, comma. Anybody got a period after verse 19 at the end of where it says Jesus Christ, Spirit of Jesus Christ? Anybody got a period there instead of a comma? Good for you. Because it's one sentence. And most people don't read the rest of the sentence. I mean, think of your texts or your emails, and if someone only read half of every sentence. All right. So verse 20, and the supply of the Spirit of Jesus Christ, according to my earnest expectation and hope that in nothing I shall be ashamed, but that with all boldness as always, so now also Christ shall be magnified in my body, whether it be by life or by death. What's he referring to? he's referring back to these two kinds of preachers, and that this one group is supposedly adding affliction to his thing, but he's rejoicing over it because it's like you're giving me more fuel to stoke a bigger fire of Jesus. Because I'm just going to lay down my life by Christ, not by new creation people's understanding of laying down your life. I just want to go, grrr. Because in many cases, we're just letting people run over us or da-da-da-da or whatever. We're not comprehending Christ in the process. And therefore, we maintain our vigilance against, even if we're laying down our life, which is not laying down your life. There's never a giving up, and therefore there's never a release. Okay, so I'm saying all that, and I'm saying all that to put us in only one place, and that is, why don't we all just say, we don't know what any of this means? I mean, let's just do it now. Let's just say, you know what? I don't know what that means. I learned a bunch of stuff when I was in Bible school, but, you know, I want to know, Lord. Why don't we just do that for the rest of this class? Why don't we approach this whole class like, Lord, you teach me. Holy Spirit, you're my teacher, not Randy up there. And if he says stuff wrong and it's out of whack, just blind my eyes and close up my ears so I don't hear that. And if he's bringing forth something that's really of you, let it just sound like a trumpet, the trumpet of the Lord sounding in my being. Instead of, it's a pretty good class. Holy, holy, holy. You know, God, we can do that for years. Oh, wait a minute, we've already done that. All right, so some of you new people, don't be like us. Don't do it. Don't be like us. Make every moment fresh with the Lord, and every class an expectation and an excitement in your heart that God will actually give you the meaning. In a certain sense, it's like I'm up here speaking in tongues, and you need to ask the Holy Spirit to give you the interpretation. And I'm just telling you that because this subject, and we'll prove this when we get into chapter 2, this subject, it's so easy to misunderstand. I mean, it really is easy to misunderstand. So why don't we just pray just real quick. Father, we ask the Holy Spirit to be released in our gathering. Every time we come together and an excitement and an expectation in the hearts of those who come to hear from you, but also to set on the shelf old concepts and ways of perceiving. And Lord, if you end up showing the very same thing, make it by life so that it's more real today than it would be tomorrow. And if you end up showing Christ in a brand new way that is life-giving and wondrous, then let it be also in all of the people and all of those gathered and all of those that are listening and all of those who might be watching by video, that your Son would be truly seen and honored in the right way, in the true way. In Jesus' name. Amen. All right, so let's see. My little comment on verse 20. His present imprisonment, along with the people who assume they are adding affliction to his pitiful state, get this, get ready, is all in accord with his earnest expectation and hope that in nothing, whether it's this or anything else, he will be ashamed, but that whether life comes or death, that Christ will be magnified in him by resurrection life or by crucified life. Could that be? I think that might be what he's talking about here. And if so, and if not, why is there a comma at the end of verse 19? And then he goes right into this thing of it being an issue of life and death and life out of death. And it doesn't matter if it's those who are preaching Christ in sincerity or those who are trying to add affliction. I'm absorbing it all by the nature of Christ and turning it into a whole different substance called resurrection. A release of Christ will come forth in a greater measure because of this Spirit of Christ, the supply of the Spirit of Christ. And a greater release of the Spirit of Christ will be set forth. So that's the significance of his words. So that, again, same sentence, comma, verse 19, da 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 da, in nothing. Doesn't matter which way this goes. For us, it tends to matter. I want everything to be resurrection. I want everything to be blessing. I want everything to be joyful and happy and comfortable and wonderful. I want to serve a wonderful Jesus who will give me a wonderful life. Well, anybody want to serve somebody like that? You know? I have thoughts, but I shan't say them. He's saying, I don't want to be ashamed, Lord. I don't want to shame you. I want, whether things come by life or by death, I want you magnified literally in me. And this is my earnest expectation, that nothing will throw me off. Nothing will set me back. Nothing will nothing will stop the living waters of Christ within me as his well. Out of your innermost being shall flow rivers of living water. You are his well. And remember now, in Genesis, who was it that stopped up the wells? The Philistines. The uncircumcised Philistines. No cross. No taking away of the flesh. Well, there are a lot of Philistine Christians. Come on. Love me or hate me, it's the truth. But there is. That's just a fact. You know, I don't think from that we're supposed to rise up and condemn them or whatever. I think the thing we're supposed to do is rise up and embrace Christ, and whether they or the world, you know, comes to put us to death and wrongly accuse us and put things upon us that we didn't do, I think that we should be able to handle it by Christ. By the Spirit of Christ. By the Spirit of the Crucified. Capital C. The Spirit of the Crucified. And I've always appreciated this word magnified. Magnified. That this Christ shall be magnified in my body. You know what a magnifying glass does. It makes things even bigger. I want him to be bigger. But what is our definition of being bigger? Well, I want him to be bigger so that I have more peace, so that even this, that I don't freak out as much. Paul wants him to be bigger so that he's bigger, so there's more of him. So he's bigger. It's more of Jesus. I have a bigger Jesus, not than you. I am I am seeing Christ increase in me. Well, guess what? One of the best ways to see Christ increase in you is by all this stuff that Paul's going through or you're going through. You know? Oh, yes.
Just a little thing. Magnifying glass also focuses light to catch things on fire.
Amen. Well, you know, God is a consuming fire. Folks, the consuming fire only falls on an acceptable sacrifice. I mean, that's what he's looking for, because then there will be a release of the sweet savor of Christ, which I promise you that's what it's talking about, because that is right over in Ephesians 5, verse 1 and 2. Be ye therefore followers of God as dear children, and walk in love as Christ also hath loved us and hath given himself for us, an offering and a sacrifice to God for a sweet smelling savor. That's the consuming thing, as it burns up the flesh, but there is a sweet savor of Christ that comes from, and that's what we want the Father to get. I mean, this is not about happy Christianity life earth. It's not about that. It is about him for those whose hearts are with him. And if a person's heart isn't there, then you know, you want to stoke that fire. But I've found that a lot of people, and this does bother me, and not, you know, it doesn't, but I mean, it just bothers me, that there are people that want to get close to God, but they don't want to get too close to God. And I see that all the time, not here, but I mean, with people. I have watched people get right up to a certain junction, and then they knew the cost is about to start. Oh, I love this revelation of Christ stuff. Oh, I love this Christ in you stuff. I love, you know, again, there ain't no Christ in you, or the Christ that is in you to the degree that you decrease, because there is an increase, but there has to be a decrease also. And so when we begin to, you know, that was one thing I appreciated about the Pharisees. Jesus would talk and he'd say, you know, well, the blind, if you say you see, then you're blind. He said this to the bunch of Pharisees. If you say you see, then you're blind. But if you're blind, because he just healed a blind man, then you see. And they got all mad. I was proud of them. I was proud of those Pharisees. At least they understood what was going on. You know what I'm saying? I mean, they're like, wait a minute, are you saying, you know, the rest of it, you know, yeah, I'm in. You know, I believe it, you know. And then we walk up to an altar and don't crawl on it. We go, you need to get up on here. You got more problems than I do. The altar is not first and foremost about problems. It isn't. The one who went to the altar, or the lamb that went to the altar, was innocent. And really the goat was innocent. They laid all their sins on the goat. The sins of Israel put on that goat, and then said, you go to the altar, and you go to the wilderness, wander in the wilderness, and let the beasts rip you and tear you. See, but while they may be a sin offering, they were all innocent. They were carrying somebody else's junk. 1 minute, or did you have a thought? Okay. Does this mean half a minute?
Yes.
Okay. All right, let's take a break and we'll come back. I have a feeling.